All right. Good morning, everybody. We were just, drawing straws for who was going to lead hymns today. So it's good to lead hymns. We just have to make the decision who's going to do it. Glad to have you guys here today. And hopefully all of you were able to take part in the wonderful breakfast that we had this morning. And thank you to those who helped get that set up and planned and everything else. It was a good experience. We are going to get started this morning with nothing but the blood. And would you please stand if you are able and sing along with us.
What can wash away my sin? What can make me whole again? What can cleanse me from within? Nothing but the blood. For my part in this I see, for my cleansing this my plea. Draw my wandering heart to thee. Nothing but the blood. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace. This is all my righteousness. Lord, in you I find my rest. Nothing but the blood. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone. Not the good that I had done, but by your grace this war is won. Nothing but the blood. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Side by side, we will work with each other, we will.
Sorry about the lyrics there for a minute. Oh, but we had the order
reversed. We're trying to be more inclusive and have one instead of man. Ours say one, right. And yours said man. So.
You are my joy. You are my song. My portion, my salvation.
slightly different couple weeks here. Oh, thank you. Magically, I'm really loud. All right, couple weeks. We're going to walk on a slightly different path. We're in between series, so come on out tonight, and we're going to talk and think a little bit about the heart. The heart. So next week, I want you to think about our quarterly business meeting. Right? And as you're aware, most of the time at a business meeting is spent reviewing. Right? We review minutes, we review information, and it's really part of the ministry of trust and transparency. Trust is a great thing, and we like to rely on trust as little as possible. So we like to be transparent in what's going on and come on out to join in knowing what's going on and what's being done and how the various leaders around the church are stewarding the resources they've been entrusted with. That will be next week following the service. And also next week, we're going to have a special multi-church worship event at the band shell, unless it's raining, and then we'll come here. But plan to be out there. It'll be a night of worship and prayer and fellowship. We're, as a church, wrestling with the idea that success is measured in terms of discipleship and spiritual growth, connection to God. This is an opportunity to be yet again connected with God in worship with others as we pray over our community and spend time worshiping together. You'll see a couple more announcements in there. We're going to have a special announcement about some upcoming camp opportunities. Thank you. As we will shortly have a message about how everyone is a needed part, and that's a value that we're having. And we're going to take a couple minutes to greet one another. And I want you to think about this question and be prepared to share a short story about a time you realized every part of your body is a needed part. Okay, so here's my short story. College. I was getting ready to leave, second year, still young, and then my back, just crippling pain. I'm like, oh, this is what people talk about when their back hurts. I can't move. And just like, wow, that one little thing, and suddenly my whole body is useless. So share a short story about when you learned every part of your body is a needed part. Take a couple minutes.
Please remain standing as we sing our entrance hymn. Our entrance hymn is number 546 in your hymnals. We're going to do verses 1, 3, and 4. Standing for the blessing.
Let us pray. Lord God, we are your people, the family of God, the body of Christ, a holy nation, a kingdom of priests. From the many, we are one, united through one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and empowered by one Holy Spirit. In our unity, may Jesus, the head of the body, be exalted in our midst today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
be seated. Our children's chorus today is the Butterfly Song. If I were a butterfly, I'd thank you, Lord, for giving me wings. And if I were a robin in a tree, I'd thank you, Lord, my heaven tree. Thank you. If I were a fish in the sea, I'd wiggle my tail and I'd giggle with glee. But I just thank you, Father, for making me. You gave me a heart and you gave me a smile. You gave me Jesus and you made me a child. And I just thank you, Father, for making me me. If I were an elephant, I'd thank you, Lord, by raising my trunk. And if I were a kangaroo, I'd just hop right up to. And if I were an octopus, I'd thank you, Lord, for my good looks. But I just thank you, Father, for making me me. For you gave me a heart and you gave me a smile. You gave me Jesus and you made me a child. But I just thank you, Father, for making me. If I were a wiggly worm, I'd thank you, Lord, that I could squirm. And if I were a crocodile, I'd thank you, Lord, for my big smile. And if I were a fuzzy wuzzy bear, I'd thank you, Lord, for my fuzzy wuzzy hair. But I just thank you, Father, for making me. You gave me a heart and you gave me a smile. You gave me Jesus and you made me a child. And I just thank you, Father, for making me me. Should have checked my lyrics. They didn't all match up, so I had to go off the screen. We will now have our scripture readings.
Our first scripture reading is Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. It can be found on page 1605 of the Pew Bibles. After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out, Joanna, the wife of Cusa, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. Our offertory prayer, let us pray. Father God, as we journey through life, steer us away from the endless desires for more. Keep us also from the strangling pinch of not having enough. May we have what we need to live generously and fairly, being a blessing to all around us, in our families, our church, and our community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our next reading is from the book of John, chapter 6, verses 1 through 14, which can be found on page 1655 of the Pew Bibles. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is, the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the miraculous signs he had performed on the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover feast was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 8 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far will they go among so many? Jesus said, have the people sit down. There was plenty of grass in that place, and the men sat down, about 5,000 of them. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted. So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. After the people saw the miraculous sign that Jesus did, they began to say, surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world. Jesus, knowing that they had intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself.
Imposter syndrome. That was the only obvious explanation I could find for what was unfolding around me in our New Testament colloquium. It's a special gathering of all of the doctoral students and faculty where we get together once a week to talk about a particularly relevant topic. And here is this world-famous scholar. I mean, there's scholars and there's scholars, and he's a world-famous international scholar pumping out all kinds of research. And he was asked what he thought about this topic. We were talking about the philosophy of biblical interpretation, and he says, you know, that's not in my wheelhouse, so I don't really have anything to say on it. And on the one hand, you appreciate the humility. That's not his area of expertise, so he doesn't speak to it. But on the other hand, that's the point of a colloquium. You get everyone together with all of their different areas of specialty and all of their different views and share ideas about a topic. And here is this world-famous New Testament scholar who feels unequipped to speak before his grad students about a particular area that he teaches on. Like, wow, you feel that too. I mean, who hasn't felt that you don't belong in the gathering, that you're the odd one out, that everyone else is competent, but not you? Right? Imposter syndrome, it's something we all wrestle with, even up to the highest levels of expertise about whatever field. And imposter syndrome is debilitating. When you conclude you don't really belong, you hold back what you could otherwise bless people with, because you're afraid of being judged, you're afraid of being weighed and found inadequate. So you make yourself small and hope no one notices. You look down so you don't make eye contact. We struggle with imposter syndrome in the church as well. And I want to speak today about kind of an antidote to imposter syndrome. As we've worked through thinking about some core values we're seeking to embrace as a church, we value that, we value biblical truth. We value that lives are changed in relationships. We value that volunteers are our ministry to build up. They don't exist to do ministry. We value that you measure success in terms of discipleship and growth, not in terms of numbers or just numbers. And today we're thinking about how we value that everyone is a needed part. Everyone has something to offer that no one else does. And when we live with the imposter syndrome attitude, we just make ourselves small because we don't want to be found lacking. But when we live trying to avoid being found lacking, we're not able to bless others with what we have. Our scriptures today is 2 stories of people who don't get a lot of press in the Gospels. Mainly the Gospels are about Jesus for a really obvious reason. They're speaking about God come to earth, God's Son, and what he's up to and what he's about. But it's only really highlighted in this one spot in Luke that as Jesus walked around the countryside, some women were following him and paying for him what he needed. You know, we can't cast out demons, we can't heal the sick, but we can buy you dinner. And so they walked around traveling with him and provided for him and his followers so that they could go about doing ministry. Or likewise the boy, as Jesus is preparing to feed this crowd, no doubt, if it were God's will, Jesus could have just miraculously made bread rain from heaven. No need to start with anything. But throughout Scripture, God shows incredible reticence to work outside of the agency of people. And so the little boy with a tiny amount of food says, here, you can use this. And Jesus multiplies it to feed everyone. He doesn't say, this is inadequate, it won't work. He says, take my inadequacy and do something with it. And Jesus does that and blesses. And learning to adopt that sort of loaves and fishes attitude and how we live towards each other. I want to unpack this idea of everyone is a needed part with three different pictures, three different levels, like we've been doing as we've worked through our core values. So the first one I want to talk about is learning to be present with a purpose through pig herding. Okay, so I grew up raising pigs. I learned lots of things from pig farming. If we've got a short video back there, if we can queue up and see. All right, so here's a guy moving some pigs. Okay, notice he's got a nice barn, nice set fences, and it's going all right. That one's going, that's nice. Let's see what this next pig does. Okay, yeah, this is more of the pig herding that sticks in my mind. And here we go. Here comes Super Pig. Can't quite make it, but A for effort. All right, so the funny thing about pigs, and you observe here, if it sees somewhere, it will go there. It will push you out of the way, it will push over fences, it will push through barriers. If it sees it and it wants to go, it's going, and you really can't stop it. It's bigger than you and it's stronger than you. So we had all kinds of circuses because we didn't have the nice barns and nice walls. All kinds of circuses chasing pigs around the fields, out of the house, all over. And the one thing you really learn is the key to moving pigs is controlling what they can see, right? You can't actually force them to go once they're more than little, but you control what they see and they'll walk towards what they can see. And you give them the time and they'll eventually go. So most of the time you need someone with a board over here and someone with a board behind them and someone with a board over here so they only see the direction that you want them to go. When it works well, nobody's pushing the pig. It's just walking. You're not doing anything, you're just there. But if you're not there, it doesn't work. The pig goes wherever it wants. The people on the side are really just there to be there. They're present, they're not pushing, but they have a key purpose. And that's very much like how ministry should work and does work a lot of the time. We see people up here leading things. We see our Sunday school teachers. We see our praise team. We see me up here teaching. And we conclude that's where the ministry of the church happens, that's where life change happens. And it's true, those are all aspects that contribute to life change. But so much of life change happens in the interactions with everyone sitting out here who are present with a purpose. You're here, you may not even think that you're doing ministry, but you're having an offhanded conversation with someone on the way out, asking them how their life is going, talking to them about what's going on. This is where life change actually works out in real life, is when we're just kind of here together doing things, being present with a purpose. That's our first way of, right, everyone's needed, because if we just have a bunch of people teaching, no one's present actually changing, no one's present actually doing ministry. You'll be present with the purpose because you're needed. It doesn't actually work without you. All right, so there's our first way of thinking about how everyone is needed. Pig herding. you need the person there controlling the line of sight, even though they're not shoving the pig anywhere. Okay, second way of thinking about it. Are you smarter than a second grader? There was a TV show on, it's got to be a couple decades ago now, Jeff Foxworthy, Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader? You get someone in there and against the fifth grade class, and they try to work through fifth grade questions. Okay, well, we'll think about second graders instead. Are you smarter than a second grader? So second graders, for perspective, think about like 8, 9-year-olds, okay? Who do second graders think are cool? It's not college students. Third graders, fourth graders, maybe fifth graders, certainly not college students. They don't have the capacity to understand anything meaningful about the world of a college student. They may be cool in like a super far removed sense, but they're not cool in the like, I want to be like them sense. You don't have any idea what their life is really like. But those third graders, they're big, they're strong, they're smart, they're fast, maybe the fourth graders. I can imagine myself being like that third grader when I'm a second grader. And that's so true throughout life in general. We can be inspired by the elite. The elite, whether they're elite athletes or elite doctors or elite teachers, the people who are at the top of their game, the top of the heap, we can look at them and be inspired. But it's usually inspiration from a long ways off and not really like, how do I get to there? What we need to move the next step in our own growth is not the elite, but someone who's just a little bit further down. Someone who knows how to say, okay, here's the next step you take. And I think in sort of church life, Martin Luther, the reformer, was legendary for his prayer life in his day. In the midst of a hugely busy, multinational reformation that he's kind of leading, he began every day with 2 hours of prayer. That's inspiring. But to be perfectly frank, I have no idea how to get to beginning your day with 2 hours of prayer. I don't know. But someone who begins their day with 15 minutes of prayer, 5 minutes, they're someone who's doing something that you can actually conceive as part of your life. What you need is not the elite. What you need is the third grader to your second grader who can help you make the next step. And as we think about being a church, being a group together of people, what we need are more places where we're willing to say, hey, I'm a second grader here, and I need a third grader to show me the next step, something that's manageable for me to do. I'm hearing this teaching, and I want to act, but I don't know how. Someone show me the next step. And when we look at the all of us, the group, that's why we need everyone. We don't just need specialists. Specialists are great. In a church context, right, I'm up here, I'm a specialist at teaching the church. We have our Sunday school teachers, we have our worship leaders. Specialists are great, they're important. And yet as soon as we conclude that it's a specialist's job, that means it's not my job, and that means I'm not gonna do it, and we excuse ourselves out of the running. Specialists are good, but what we need more in church are willing learners who will say, I'm a second grader in prayer. Is there a third grader here that can show me the next step? I'm a second grader when it comes to hosting people in my house. Is there a third grader? Or maybe you can say, look, I'm a third grader in Bible study, and I see that you're maybe a second grader. Here, let me help you. And the next step. Everyone is a needed part because we all have strengths and weaknesses. We all have different experiences and abilities that we can share with one another to help the next step along. But when we measure our abilities in terms of inadequacy, then we never share them. We never share that next blessing with someone else. We hold it back. We don't want to be found lacking. But God has given us different gifts. And right, to be perfectly frank, you are lacking, and I am lacking. God doesn't say, come to me, you who are complete and capable. He says, right, the weary, the weak, the heavy laden. He's the one who makes adequate our inadequate efforts. And as much as it's Jesus who multiplies the loaves and fishes, but the little boy gave them. And that's so much how God continues to intend to work in our midst. By each one of us saying, okay, I've got some loaves and fishes of this kind. What can God do with them if I'm willing to share them? So everyone is a needed part. When we think about herding pigs, you're needed to be present there in the right spot, the right time, even if you're not obviously doing anything. We think about being a third grader to someone else's second grader so you can help with the next step along. And one more picture for considering how everyone is a needed part. The ecosystem. Or like our Northwoods ecosystem up here, lakes, ponds, streams, lots of the Northwoods creatures and plants. So we have, you know, your average lake. You've got your fish in it. You've got the ducks in it. You've got some mammals who go around it. Your turtles. There's one particular member of our ecosystem up here that most people dislike. The mosquito. And lots of people would be happy if mosquitoes disappeared, and I'm not sure I would complain about it. There's roughly 3,500 subspecies of mosquitoes around the world, and only a handful of them actually bite people, and God blessed the UP with an abundance of the kind that bite people. But within the ecosystem, they're more than just an obnoxious pest to people. They actually do many things. The adults pollinate, which is a useful thing. The larvae, which live in lakes and streams, and your rain barrels if you don't have a cover on them. But lakes and streams, the fish eat them, and then the little fish are eaten by the bigger fish that we like to catch and eat, and we appreciate. Birds eat mosquitoes, bats eat mosquitoes, other bugs eat mosquitoes. Most people think dragonflies are pretty. Well, that's one of the things they eat. And also, as larvae in those lakes and streams, they eat algae. Take away the mosquitoes, and you know, the ecosystem's probably not going to collapse. But our fish populations will have less food. They won't do as well. Our lakes and ponds will have a lot more algae, which is nasty looking. Our birds and bats will have to figure out something else to eat. In short, a lot of what we actually like about the Northwoods ecosystem requires mosquitoes. They're a part. And that's the thing about ecosystems is there are cool species in an ecosystem and there are obnoxious ones, but you can't really pick and choose. It's a whole package deal, and you start removing ones that you don't like, and you send the ecosystem towards demise. Right? They don't get better as you start removing species. They just collapse. Maybe it's a long, slow collapse, or maybe it's an instantaneous one, depending on the type of species, but that's what happens when you start removing, when the whole ecosystem isn't participating anymore, it falls to pieces. And boy, that's so much like the pictures of the church that God gives us. There are some members of the ecosystem, the deer, the bear, the wolves, those are cool, and we like them, and we know them, and we understand them. Mosquitoes are obnoxious, and we don't see the importance of them, but that doesn't change that they are important. Right? And when we think of the church, we see certain people doing ministry, and they would be pointed out as the important ones, but that's not really true. It's the whole. Everyone is a needed part. You start pulling out here and here and there, and eventually you set the church on a one-way ticket to dwindling, to demise, and to eventual collapse. Everyone is needed. We're equipped and blessed and given skills, abilities, experiences to bless one another, to share with one another. And even beyond that, there's a funny reality about both ecosystems and the church is their boundaries are really fuzzy. Eventually, you move out of the Northwoods ecosystem into a different one, but you can't pinpoint exactly where that is. And likewise, at the church, eventually you move from a here's the church to here's those outside the church in our community, but that boundary gets pretty porous, and it should, especially as we start to think more and more, how can we bless as a church? How can we use our abilities, the grace gifts God has given us, not just for one another, but also to bless those who are not part, maybe never will be, maybe will be, we don't know. But God has given us abilities to share with one another and to share with our friends, our family, our community. The church is like an ecosystem. Everyone is a needed part. Find your niche of blessing. If you have a bulletin, you have the usual note sheet, and you'll see on the back, thinking about what is your niche, it just listed a bunch of possible really practical things that might be something you can do. You might look at offer to give rides and think, I'm never going to give a ride to someone I don't know very well. You might think, hey, I can do that. I'm happy to give rides. Well, there's people who need rides, if that's something you would be able to do. Pick up litter when you see it walking. Pray consistently for others. Pray consistently with others. There's many very specific actions that you can do. Look at these. Think about your own self and what is a niche where I would love to bless other people. Find your niche in the ecosystem. Because the church needs everybody. Everyone is a needed part. We need people to stand on the edges and hold boards that aren't obviously doing anything, but the whole thing falls apart when you take them away. We need third graders who can say, hey, I'm not the specialist, but I know the next step. So here, come with me. And we need to see ourselves more like an ecosystem where it's not obvious how every part fits together, but you start pulling parts out and suddenly it all falls apart. So how are you equipped to bless others? We need one another. What are your loaves and fishes? I think back to that colloquium with my internationally famous New Testament professor who by all appearances seemed ashamed to give his answers on a topic of concern that we were all there to discuss as non-specialists in the area. And I think of how powerful that imposter syndrome can be, that sense that I might be ashamed by the answer I give if I open up and share something I have to share. And you know, it's okay to be a second grader in some area. God has blessed you with a third grader in your life who can help you on the next step. That's why we're here together. Imposter syndrome should not rule the church. The deep sense that God blesses us with his grace to help one another should rule the church. Which means, hey, there are areas I need help. There are areas where I can give help. And we share them with one another. Everyone is a needed part. Where can you be a blessing to someone else? Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for such a beautiful picture of a little boy who, faced with an overwhelming need, said, I've got this little bit, do something with it. And Lord, what a picture that is for us, that we don't need to solve the overwhelming needs, but to just be willing to give what little we have. Our little area of ability to bless others and to trust that the God who can multiply the loaves and fishes can also multiply the effect of our willingness to be obedient and bless in certain areas. Help us as a church to embrace deeply that everyone is a needed part, and that means each one of us get to say truly, I am a needed part. May your Spirit help us find how we are needed. May you give us wisdom to help one another find how we are needed, so that we become a community defined by giving and receiving of love to one another, and by love which pours out around the edges into our lives, into our community, so others too may see the hope and joy we have in Jesus the Rescuer, in whose name we pray. Amen.
We will now be singing hymn number 323, verses 1, 3, and 4. Would you please stand and sing with me?
All my life long I had planted for the lake from some cool spring that I hope would quench the burning of the thirst I felt within. Hallelujah, I have found him who my soul so long has craved. Jesus satisfied my longings, through his blood now am saved. Poor I was and sought for riches, something that would satisfy. But the dust I gathered round me only mocked my soul's sad cry. Hallelujah, I have found him whom my soul so long has craved. Jesus satisfies my longings, through his blood I now am saved. Well of water ever springing, bread of life so rich and free, untold wealth that never faileth, my Redeemer is to me. Hallelujah, I have found him whom my soul so long has craved. Jesus satisfies my longings, through his blood I now am saved.
You may be seated.
We come at this time to our celebration of the Lord's Supper, or communion, which is a celebration, a remembrance of the rescue that Jesus brings, and it also is a celebration of our togetherness, that when you gather together, Jesus instructs his followers, do this in remembrance of me. And we remember now that Jesus has rescued us as a people, as a family, a plurality, and we're all needed. We're all blessed with the same grace, but we don't have the same grace gifts to share with one another. We all have different things we can share. So we come in this celebration. If you want, the servers want to come forward. Here we practice open communion, which what that means is as we pass, first we'll pass the bread and everyone will take it together and then the cup. If you are a follower of Jesus in faith, we welcome any and all to participate. And we will pass these shortly. And first I want to join with me in prayer as we reflect on the bread that we will share. Lord, as we take and share this bread, we remember Jesus, the bread of life, the one who provides life. Lord, you feed our souls, you nourish our hearts, and you give us a hope to power us in running the race that runs before us. May we know this hope more and more deeply. Thank you, King Jesus. Amen. The Apostle Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Join me now in prayer as we reflect on the cup that we will share together. Lord, as we drink, we remember you as the giver of living water. You are forgiveness, the one who brings a peace that passes all understanding. Your love flows within us, and we thank you for the blood of Jesus, the blood which brings the life of the new covenant to all who believe. We say thank you, King Jesus. Amen. Thank you. In the same way, also, Jesus took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Paul continues writing, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And we join in this communion in that proclamation of the victorious, life-giving death of Jesus. As is our custom now, we will stand and sing, "Blessed Be the Ties That Binds." If you feel comfortable with it, you can join hands with those around you.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above.
You can be seated. We come to a time of prayer.